So 76 Booksy came up, that's it. And started playing with Booksy. You know, he formed a little band. And he was like, I mean, he was, in those days, he was somebody ahead of his time in those days. And he just blew our mind with it. You know, his arrangement and his musical ability just blew our mind as young boys growing up in England at the time. And he stayed for a couple of years. And when he left, we thought we got to go and join a band, because we can't, you know, he left us just there, you know, and we did before. We had to go, the music he gave us was so superior. We thought at the time we had to go and join the best band then to match what he was doing. And at that time, the best band at the time was Metronome. So we said, look, me and a few of the boys said, look, we're going to join Metronome. So we were young guys and we went to join Metronome. And, you know, we played there for a little while. And look, I remember, I don't know if you remember this, but we said, oh, we're going to play in a club. We're going to be the resident band in a club called McKinley's. McKinley's, which Alex used to own this club. And I was a young boy, well, you part of the host in the club. And I was a young boy playing in this club called McKinley's, and I felt like a star because, you know, I used to go to this club every Saturday night. And it was a nice club in Bellside, in Hampstead, Bellside Park. And we played there for, you know, I think about a year. About a year, year and a half we played there for every Saturday. And it was good times. And as a young boy growing up, you know, I mean, I'm just taking you back to show you where I'm coming from now. Yeah, to show you, where, you know, how things have developed over the years. And so after playing in the Kidneys for a little while, you know, that's about a year and a half, you know, we started going on tour, really went to Switzerland, went a couple of times, went to Belgium. And at that time, you know, it was still, bands wasn't really touring as much. There was the, you know, the original band that Casper and a few other bands was touring, but big bands, like our bands, because we're what you call a conventional band, a big band, wasn't really touring like that at that particular time. And I mean, I took over Metronomes, I think it was about 1983, 84, no, 80, 85, sorry. And it was funny because coming to the management part of it now, when I took over Metronomes, there was a case of where everybody was like, yeah, you know, change, and there were certain different things happening in the band at the time. And we, you know, we said we wanted some change. And I was a popular guy. After the first year, I was an enemy because my experience in this was that, and I think anybody who runs anything in life is that you can't please everybody all the time. Yeah, no matter what you do, somebody's going to be affected. And so you have to take that line with look. You have to do what is good for the band and what is good for, you know, what's good for the band. You've got to take that direction. And we have to form a system where Metronome to the band that is steeped in history. And even now, we've got a lot of old heads in the band. And I'm like in the middle, and we've got a lot of youngsters. So what we do, we have this system where, all right, I will take advice or listen to the old heads, and then listen to the younger ones, and then make a decision. Yeah, and that's by doing that, you build a bond with your band. You build a bond. Yeah, and everybody feels involved. But there is sometimes where, as a leader, you have to take the front and say, listen, we're going so, this is what we're doing. You know, there's times where you have to be, I have to be single-minded at a certain time. But it's a case of balancing what you do, you know? And in our band, we, like every other band, big bands have their ups and downs. Running a big band is not easy, trust me. Yeah, you have a lot of financial problems, because when you're in a big band, it's not like a gig band where, you know, you go and you play, and after the end of the play, after you finish playing your performance, you want the money. They don't talk, give some bucks. When you play in a big band, that money has to come back into the band. And every now and then you might give another person some extra expenses or whatever, you know, because you've got some serious expenses. When you have a gig band, you know, you just put in somebody's front room and the rehearsals. Big band, you have to have a hall, or you have to pay rent, you have to pay light bill. You know, you've got serious overheads. And people don't understand this. And sometimes, I mean, and even this, the funding. Funding is something where, you've got to remember, there's a small little top, and you've got like about 100 different groups applying for this small little top that somebody ain't going to get. You can't get all the time. And I think a lot of us, what we do, a lot of bands, rely on funding too much. yeah? We rely on funding too much, and we have to start, you know, doing it for ourselves and not relying on these people and relying to them, begging them, like a begging bowl, looking for funding all the time. Do it for ourselves. So what we try to do is in our band, right, is that end of the day, we go on gig, my band will go on gig, and then that money comes back in the pot. You understand? And then we do what we have to do, and if there's a little bit left over, then we'll give a little change. But we don't, if funding, don't get me wrong, if the funding is there, we will take it. We will take the funding, but we're not going to rely on the funding. Because that's how bands mash up. That's how organizations are destroyed. Because what they do, they don't like something you do, they take it away from you. And you're lost because you're dependent on this all the time. What are we going to do? We haven't got it. We can survive. We survive for so long. Why can't we survive now? We just got to put our heads together and realize that our potential. Yeah? And I mean, that's what I'm trying to instill in our band. And we survive without funding for years. When it comes, we take it. Like, I'm not going to say we don't take it. But at the same time, you know, anything we do, we get that money, we put it up top, and we do it collectively. Yeah, I've always tried to instill that in our band, because at the end of the day, it's not easy. It is not easy running a big band. And you're talking about, our band, we've got like 80 members. You've got like 80 different personalities. Yeah, you've got to try and fuse all of that into one and make that into a unit and create a vibe. Because to me, when a band is about having vibe, having vibrancy, having beings, you know what I mean, having that spirit. It's not just about, we every year and this, that. No. We try to instill that a band is about spirit. When you play your music, you're happy. And you can feel what you're doing. And you can feel, when you finish, you can say, yeah, you know what? I enjoy that. You know, that's my soul. You understand what I'm saying? And this is what music's all about. And we always stress this thing about win, win. We're so wrapped up in this kind of thing that we forget that music is about beauty and about feeling. You know, and we need to get back to that. You know, oh, it's nice to win, you know, nothing wrong with human beings. It's nice to feel we're the best. But at the same time, let's keep it real and keep it get down to the basics and say, listen, no, what we're doing here, you know, we're doing something out of love. And because we love what we do. At the end of the day, I mean, even people who gig, they still love PAN. You know, it's nice to get paid for it as well. But in the big bands, people don't get paid. They come practice in the cold, in the rain, you know, they come and they play, and then they're socialized and they go home. And next week they say, well, boy, I need some money for bus fare, I need some money for train fare, and they're going home empty-handed. You understand? But they're still back next week. Why? Why? Because they love what they do. This thing here, as somebody said to me, well, this is a jumpy. This is seriously a jumpy because a lot of us here, if we put our minds to other things, we could have been rich people by now. I know that for a fact. But because we love this so much, yeah, it's a jumpy. You know, and by rights, I mean, there's so many people here, and so many PAN players who should be wealthy, who should be rich, who should have Rolls Royces or Bentleys outside their parked up all now. You understand? Instead of going to look at a train on the bus. You know? But we haven't got that. You understand? We haven't got that. But, you know, we still keep on, because we love what we do and we love the PAN. Listen, I'm not going to stay too long. I'm going to leave you now because I think we're getting on a bit now. So I want to say thank you very much for having me here. It was nice to meet you. Thank you.
Thank you. It's nice to catch up with the younger people again. I like that. We wouldn't go for long. Gerald is going to return on a happy note. And the band is going to play the happy note likewise. Gerald.
We are about to conclude now. The title of the song, this was a road march, as we call it in the Caribbean, many years ago. And we didn't even know the name of it because in the Caribbean we call it Valerie. It's not even Valerie. It's a German word, Valerie. And the other name is Happy Bonnery. So can you close the show with Valerie? Wonderful. They'll be playing two songs, followed by Rabadin and Valentine. The song about Barbara and Valentine, it was when the West Indies defeated England in the 50s in cricket, and a song was composed about that. Thank you.
Thank you.
for us to get together, but I must call the man who is responsible for putting it all together to say the last word, because he has done marvelously. Let's give him all a round of applause, please. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, everybody. The people, as Alex says, we turned up. Thank you, Alex Pascal, very much for being our content for the day. Okay, you did a fantastic job. That's beautiful, thanks. And the other people who have endured this endurance is the band who have sat very patiently. The Penultimate Steel Band, okay? Which is... which is Shumi, Gary, Steffi, Miranda, okay, Kanice, DJ, Ashton, sorry about that, Mehmet, Gino, Simeon, and Lolita, okay? And we have our special guest, okay, who's been playing for many years, and he's a renowned drummer, okay? He came to help us out today, okay? He's very ill, but he still managed to come out and give us a hand, which we really do appreciate. He's not that ill, but he's ill enough, you know what I'm saying? His name is Wesley, okay? Thanks very much, and... yeah, my name is Daniel Louis. So what happens is, I'd like to thank, as I said, Gerald Forsyth and Alex Pascal, who are the main two lecturers of the day. Mr. Bravo in the back there, thanks for that breakdown. Okay, it's very important. And all the information that we have, it's going to be put onto a CD, which is a DVD, and that DVD is going to be distributed to schools and colleges and libraries and so on and so forth, okay? We also have to thank the other people, being Mr. Eric Harding and Eversley Mills, okay, for their contributions and their knowledge, because without that, you know, some of us steel bound people think, hey, it's just us, and, you know, there's nobody else, but there's a lot. There's many steel bands all over the world. If you've been watching the slideshow, you'll see there's quite a few steel bands all over the whole world. And it started in Trinidad, which is what Eversley and the rest of the elders that we were speaking about came from. Also, the history of the Caribbean music, which is extremely important to know. And we also have Robbie Joseph, who gave us the knowledge and some of the breakdown of the history of the steel band in this country. Okay? And the magazine Pound Podium, which is a really important magazine because in the day, no one else has been able to be as consistent with that as they have. And that's thanks to Robbie Joseph and BAS, which is the British Association of Steel Bands. Okay, we hope that you've enjoyed the day, and we'll put on many more of them, and thank you very much.